Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so first I would like to thank, of course, Ignacio and Frank, and also, I mean, the UMES and all the organizers of the semester for this, I mean, very nice semester and very nice workshop. What I'm going to talk about today is a joint work, I should say ongoing work, with Ignacio, Norbert, and Frank, in which we try to characterize RG fixed points in PEPs. And since it's in PEPs, we are assuming that we are kind of characterizing gapped, so we are not talking about criticality, all these things. I mean, so gapped RG fixed points. So first, I would like to even before motivating the problem, I would like to say a few words about RG, though it has appeared in many talks. I mean, Gifre, the last one, but also in again, John Wan talk and Xiaogan and Brian and many other. And the idea is simply that we have a system, and we are only considering quantum spin systems, so no fermions or things like that. So we have a many-body system. We assume, square lattice, for instance, and particles, which are, these small dots. And then what we do is we consider we divide the system in regions, like the next squares, and we try to identify the relevant degrees of freedom and discard those which are irrelevant, and we keep going. Okay, so next we consider, now our next squares will be our systems, and then we block them and discard irrelevant degrees of freedom, and so on and so forth. And in this way we try to capture, the global properties of the state, which in our particular case, in which we are interested in discarding local entanglement, will be the global entanglement of the state, so the topological order of the state. So if we do this RG transformation, we get a flow in the set of, so we have here the set of states, and we get a flow that may converge to something. And this fixed point, so of this flow, is what we call an RG fixed point. Okay, so this is the object of a study, which is an RG fixed point. So first thing is that, RG fixed points can depend, of course, the flow itself may depend a lot on the type of RG that one does on the system. But even the fixed point themselves, so being a fixed point or not, may depend on the particular procedure you decide to use as an RG. But even if this is the case, all RG fixed points share some general physical properties. For instance, some type of self-similarity. Or in the gap case, the case we're interested in, the fact that there is no length in the system. Because, by renormalizing, we are kind of destroying the length, so there is no length in the system. And we call this zero correlation length. Okay? So the first question we would like to answer is whether the fact that that a state is an RG fixed point is characterized or not by some of these physical properties. So question one is whether the reverse is true. So in our case, whether zero correlation length implies RG fixed point. And of course, for that, we have to construct the RG flow, in a sense.
Zero correlation length, but does it mean that correlation is decay the power, law of the distance?
But since we're only interested in gap systems, this is where I started with. I'm only interested in gap systems, so no criticality or CFTs or anything like that. Okay, so this is, I said it, but let me write it. This is true in the gap case. There's no length. Okay, so to make things clear. Okay, and this is the only case I'm interested in this talk. Okay, so, the main result one, if you want, is that yes. This is a informal statement. I will make formal statements of that later. Okay, and that's in a sense nice because we are able to obtain a flow from only a physical property. It's the fact that there are no length in the system. Okay, of course this is something maybe that people expect. It's not that it's something shocking, but I think it's nice to have it.
So, yes. I'm sure from gap to RG fixed point.
Excuse me, sir?
From gap yes. to RG fixed point. So maybe from gap to zero correlation length, if there's a gap of, oh, it's a pretty straightforward. When you have a gap, always imply zero correlation length.
Oh, it implies some, I mean, finite correlation length. And the thing is that, of course, by taking RG fixed point, you expect to have in the end the zero correlation length, of course. So
actually,
after
what
the flow,
I'm thinking about is actually, suppose you can have a stacking of two-dimensional watch state into a three-dimensional one, mm-hmm. and it have a gap. But because of the stacking, so there's a separation of these layers. That yes. seems some length scale there. So I wonder whether from gap to zero correlation length, whether there's a gap.
Good point. First of all, I must say also that all we are doing is in 2D. Also, so of course we won't deal with all the subtleties that John Wan put on the board. Okay, so this is crucial for us. That is 2D. Okay. Good. So, but indeed our motivation to study RG fixed point. It's not just a kind of motivation of understanding how to characterize it physically, but it comes from a different problem. So indeed, our motivation, so this could be one possible motivation, but it's not our motivation. And this motivation will introduce the second question, is the problem of classifying quantum phases. In which, of course, many people in the audience made very, very nice contributions. So let me talk a bit about this problem, and which is the exact question we want to solve related to this problem. So, Bruno already talked about this in the very first talk. And then the idea is that we have a set of local meaning finite range Hamiltonians. So this set is the set of finite range Hamiltonians in, let's say, interaction, let's say, because I'm going to work always in the traditional invariant case. So finite range interactions. Okay? And the Hamiltonian is simply the traditional invariant Hamiltonian obtained from these interactions. And then I would like to kind of divide this set in subsets in such a way that this is a partition in such a way that two points are in the same phase if and only if, okay, a definition. You want. There exists, so this is called this H0 and H1. There exists a path H lambda with lambda in 0, 1 that is smooth that connects H0 with H1 and in such a way that there is a uniform gap along the path. Uniform meaning uniform in lambda and uniform in the size of the system. Okay, this is Bruno's definition. I mean, not the one that Bruno presented. It's not his definition. It's the one he presented in the first talk. So, smooth and with uniform gap. Uniform meaning in both variables, in lambda and in the size of the system. Okay, and this is what we'd like to do. But the thing is that this is a pretty difficult problem. And gap meaning energy gap. So, the gap between the ground state and the first excited state. And the problem why this is difficult is because this is difficult. So if I want to prove that two Hamiltonians are in the same phase, I have to find a path of Hamiltonians with a gap. And for that, they have to have tools to decide when a Hamiltonian has a gap. And this is a difficult problem, so problem of deciding the gap is hard. This is hard or difficult. Okay, and indeed, it's difficult really in a rigorous mathematical sense. So it's not that it's difficult because we are not smart enough. Okay, which at least in my case, in many cases, this is the case. But no, in this case, it's difficult because it's mathematically difficult. And this is a very nice result I like a lot that we hope to post on the archive very soon, together with Toby Cubitt, Michael Wolf, and myself. In which we show that indeed this problem is undecidable. Okay? So, theorem is that this is undecided. If you want to state it properly, but this is undecided.
That means QMA hard or
no, it's much more difficult than that.
Oh.
It's really as difficult as it can be. It's equivalent to the Hoyting problem in a Turing machine. So it's really, you cannot even decide it within the axiom of mathematics. So it's really, as problem as it can be. So
what you mean is the problem of deciding if two Hamiltonians are in the same phase?
No, excuse me. It's the problem, let me state it. And then, okay, because I will state the exact theorem you want. The exact theorem is that, there exists a fixed finite D, local dimension, and you can take it if you want anything below 10,000, okay? But it's fixed. The important thing is that it's fixed. We didn't do any effort to optimize this D. This D is the local Hilbert space dimension. You can take this if you want, no problem. And then for each N, there exist local interactions, so nearest neighbor, there exist nearest neighbor interactions. Hn rho, this means that this is an Hermitian operator, so this goes from Cn, Cd, sorry, tensor Cd into itself. Okay, Hermitian. And the same for column operations, so this, of course, my system is not rotational invariant, so there's one interaction for the rows and one for the columns. With the following properties, so that all these interactions are bounded in norm. Second, they only have algebraic entries. Indeed, given n, how to obtain from n hn, this is involves only a finite number, finite meaning independent of n. Finite independent of n. Number of operations, elementary operations. Operations. Which involve only n, which involve only q. So rational numbers which are independent of n, so the same always. N itself. And n's root of unity. Okay, these are the only things that you have to do. And what you have to apply is always the same circuit, let's say, which is finite, independent of n, to fix rational numbers, n itself, and root of unity, nothing else. And this way, you obtain n from hn. So, you can do it kind of always, with the same effort, let's say. Also, this implies, in particular, that hn has only algebraic entries. And third, if the universal Turing machine run on input n holds, then the gap of the Hamiltonian in the thermodynamic limit is bigger or equal than 1/2. So this means in the thermodynamic limit. And if it does not hold, run on n. Does not hold, then the spectrum of H is the whole positive real line. Okay?
Universal Turing machine,
classical universal Turing machine, yeah, the usual one, the classical universal. And this is the formal statement. Okay? So this immediately implies that there cannot be any easy way to decide the gap looking at the local interactions, because essentially it would imply that the problem is decidable and it's not. Okay, so indeed this shows that there is no, okay, not that there is no hope, but that this problem is pretty tough. Because if I give you the local interaction, I don't even know if you are in the here or in the phase transition, because you don't know. Okay, but still,
so you don't know in general? There might be cases where
exactly, but there cannot be any algorithm that decides this. Not even in infinite time. Not a single algorithm that decides this. But of course, if you impose extra conditions on the system, like SU2 symmetry, things like that, this might become decidable. That's, I don't know. But at least I mean, let's say the general problem as I stated here cannot be solved, or it's pretty tough to be solved.
But I think you're talking about more than just classifying the possible, what the phases are. You're talking about actually determining the phase diagram.
Yes.
In the entire parameter space.
Yes.
You're saying that's undecidable.
Yes.
Because you can't even decide when there's a gap.
Yes, exactly.
But on the other hand, you can consider classifying phases in ways that do not tell you the phase diagram, they just tell you what are the phases.
Exactly. So this is my last point is now, even if this is the case, we still want to classify phases, and let's see how can possible ways to do this. And this is why, okay? So this, I completely agree with you, okay? So the thing is that even though we still want to classify the phases, so let's see possible rules to do this. Okay, we still want to classify. Okay, now of course there could be many different routes, and I'm taking one. Okay? I'm not claiming this is the best or the, I don't know, but it's the one I'm taking. Okay? So the first step is to go from, I mean, to change the view from Hamiltonian to states. Okay, the reason for that is that indeed a phase, an intuitive way of when two things are in the same phase is when they have similar properties. Of course, physical properties are things that you observe on the states. And then, in this sense, this makes sense. Okay? The thing now, of course, is that the set of states is huge. So now I change in this to the set of states. Sorry, I change this picture. I change finite range interaction by states. But of course, I'm only interested on relevant states. Because I'm interested in classifying phases for finite range interactions, so I'm only interested in classifying phases for states that come from local interactions. So I would classify phases only in the set of relevant states. Relevant in this sense. I mean, they are ground states of Hamiltonians having local interactions. Of course, this is a difficult problem on itself. But at least we have a good candidate, which is the set of PEPs. And there are some kind of analytic results by Hastings, which show that, okay, this may be true, that the set of relevant states is equal, okay, sort of, to the set of PEPs. So then what I'm going to try to do is to classify phases in the set of PEPs. Okay, now.
Can you comment on, for the chiral state, is that in here or excluded from here?
I started for me saying that I'm not talking about fermions at all, so that I'm talking.
Even for boson, you have chiral bosonic quantum Hall states. Whether assuming PEP, you include those chiral states or you exclude
them? I really don't know. I don't know.
Okay, so here you just define. I see you just try to classify PEP states.
Yes. So this is our motivation to restrict the classification to a set of PEPs. It could be true that in each one of these steps I'm missing things.
Okay,
it could be true.
Okay.
And this is something to be studied. But I mean, even if with all these reductions, the problem is keeping difficult. So it's not that kind of. But hopefully I'm reducing the complexity something. Okay? Okay, now the good thing of PEPs is that PEPs are characterized by tensors, by single objects. So the PEPs, I mean, this is talking about PEPs, is the same as talking about, you know, for instance, in the 1D case, things like that, or in the 2D case, let's see if I'm able to draw it, things like that, no? And there's a single tensor, because again, I'm interested in traditional invariant system, a single tensor, for instance, the 1D, give me, call this A. Okay, let's put the squares here. Oops. This is L. So the same tensor gives me many states, so one for each length, for each L. And of course, in the classification of phases, I'm interested in kind of the limit when L goes to infinity, but I don't care about this. So indeed, what I would like to classify is these objects, or these objects, because they define the states. Okay? So then my this set here is in 1D the set of these objects, and in 2D the set of these objects. But of course, the global properties of a state, so the properties that define the phase, topological order, or whatever, are global things. So are things that depend on this object. So the when I contract this or this many times with itself. So of course, the main difficulty in PEPs is this global versus local thing. Is I have a global property, which is the physical property I would like to study, and I would like to give a local characterization of it, which sometimes this is not trivial. So then I have this global versus local. Global is the physical property, local is how I characterize this property on the local tensor. And this has appeared in this workshop many times, of course, for instance, in the talk of Norbert, in the talk of Xie Chen yesterday, or Xiaogang Wen also, I mean, talking about different things like topology or symmetries or things like that. I mean, how one can, in principle, try to characterize these global properties locally in the PES by some gauge symmetry or some kind of symmetry, how to say, how the symmetry act, let's say, on this tensor. This is all. Okay, so in this case in particular, we would like to characterize locally the fact that we have an RG fixed point. And why? The reason is that even if we restrict to PEPs, if we keep the definition of the classification of phases by this, so I have a state, I find a Hamiltonian with a gap and a path of gap Hamiltonians that end up in a Hamiltonian that has the state as ground state. So I mean, I keep the classification of phases based on Hamiltonians, even I consider only states. Then I still have to face the problem of when, having a PEPs, I can find a Hamiltonian that has it at ground state, like the parent Hamiltonian, which has a gap. And the gap problem for parent Hamiltonians of PEPs is still unsolved. In this case, we don't have any claim that is mathematically difficult. So the most probable thing is that it's difficult because we are not smart enough. Okay, that's clear. But still, we don't know how to solve it. So then, the next reduction is, okay, let's relax a bit the definition of phase in such a way that we don't only admit kind of a path of gap Hamiltonians, which is equivalent as kind of doing kind of local unitaries in the systems, but we only allow for RG. Okay? So the next reduction, so this is still difficult. So another of course, in all of these relaxations, we can be missing things. So that's clear that it could be that we are missing phases whenever we do one of these reductions. But since, okay, we hope we are not missing much, but this is something, it's not clear. So the reduction is allow also for RG. So next reduction is to allow for RG. And then now, what we do is, okay, we would like, so step one now would be, in each phase, we would like to single out a representative, which would be some RG fixed point. So step one is single out a representative for each phase. And this would be the RG fixed point.
Is there a fixed point in every region?
Good point. It could be that no. And then we are missing the phases in which there is no fixed point, or the RG drops you to the boundary, or drops you to a different phase. So it could be that, again, by doing this, we are missing phases. Yes, I completely. It could be true, yes.
What do you mean by RG in this particular context?
Exactly. This is the... Thank you for the question. So that's the point. Since we don't have a particular flow, what we would like to see is how to characterize this representative by things that we can touch, like the zero correlation length. And this is how this step one connects with the first question. So I don't want to impose in advance any particular flow. I want to obtain it by the fact that if this exists, it must have zero correlation length. This is kind of the... And this kind of... This step one is really why question one in this context.
So you have no correlation length if you're the fixed point of any flow?
Because I'm in the middle of the gap phase. Because I'm not interested in fixed points that are here. I'm only trying to classify the gap phases.
Wait, what was question one?
Question one is whether just knowing that the state has zero correlation length, I can recover an RG flow for which this is an RG fixed point. So that RG fixed point is the same as having zero correlation length in this context.
Okay.
Okay.
What do you mean by zero correlation?
I will,
because you know, these, even the pep states, there's exponential.
No, but some of them has exactly zero correlation length. Tori code, for instance, all these. Indeed, all known topological models which are known kind of to be exact, like the string net states
the
of.
The ones that are in some in this ontology fixed points actually do have this model.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. Exactly. Good. Step two, which is something we haven't even started, is okay. Now show that these different representatives are really in different phases, because it could be that one phase has two RG fixed points. This isn't clear. So check that different RG fixed points live in different phases. Excuse me.
The trajectory will branch, how it will have two fixed points.
No, but it could be that you can go from one RG fixed point to another one by a path of gap Hamiltonians.
It's a problem with what you call RG fixed point, right?
Yeah, of course, yeah, definitely, of course. So because I'm not imposing the RG, so it could be that in the same phase there are two different RG procedures, because I'm not fixing the procedure. That are fixed points within the same phase. This, in principle, is possible. I'm not claiming it's true. It's simply that it could be possible.
You could have an unstable fixed point.
Yeah. Of course. Yes, definitely. Yes.
But what you mean then is you could have two peps with zero correlation length
within the same phase,
which belong to the same, correspond to the same phase. That's what you're saying.
Yes, definitely. Okay. Indeed, this is true.
No. But that's what you say by RG fixed point.
Yes, indeed, this is length. Yes, but indeed this is true. I mean, even in the trivial phase, there are different peps which are really different and live in the same phase. But of course, the thing is, when I mean different, meaning really different. Of course, this is something that all these things must to be formalized. I mean, because it's true that there are different RG fixed points in the same phase. This, I mean, even the trivial phase in 1D, this is true. But I mean, they are not really different. I mean, they are kind of. And this connects with step three. But okay, again, showing that something lives in different phases is something that, in principle, could be easier. Because for that, it's enough to find an invariant, or an index, some integer-valued function which behaves continuously with the gap, which is invariant in the phase. And of course, if two of these things have different integer values for this index or this invariant, it's clear that they must be in different phases. And this is why, for instance, in this classification of phases in 1D, with this cohomology, this can be done, because it's... It is an integer value thing that takes different values. No? So this could be doable, but I guess, I mean, we haven't even started in this case. But the step three, of course, the thing is not only classify things. The thing is how to understand the physics of the phase based on your representative. Because, of course, if you classify things but you cannot say anything about the properties, physical properties of the phase, this is completely useless. So step three is use this representative to know which is the physics in the phase.
What do you mean by physics?
It's a very good question, definitely. Since in principle these are different topological phases, so the topological properties of the braiding, fusion rules, all these things, the topological properties of each one of the phases. How can I read them from the structure I have in my representative? So I give you this local tensor, I tell you some RG fixed point, and I tell you, give me, for instance, which are the braiding properties, the fusion rules, the number of particles of this thing. This, is, in principle, can be very difficult, even if you have this description to obtain. And in this, the next talk of Yuto I advertise is exactly about this step three. And it's, I think, a very impressive improvement in this step three. Okay, so this is Yuto's talk. But now, of course, and this talk is about step one. Okay, this talk, or what remains of it, is about step one. And now, the second question, all this is to motivate our second question, is, of course, that we would like to solve step one in such a way that it helps us to solve step three. So we would like to have a representative which has a handable description which allows us to extract the physics. Okay, so... Question two is is related to, I would relate it to going from step one, which is this talk, to step three, okay, which is Jutos.
Okay. Do you imply step two is still open question?
Oh, yeah, of course. We didn't even start in this to think about this. So I don't know how difficult we are still working here. So okay. So
of course, step three can be tackled directly, classifying, particularly in the two-dimensional case, classifying things in terms of non-trivial quasi-particles. Well, trivial and non-trivial. Quasi-particles, fusion walls, grading, modular transformation properties, and all that can be tackled directly and has been.
I completely agree. But it's not clear that we are not missing things. It could be that there is a phase in which you don't have these kind of fusion rules or an algebraic.
I don't really think that's possible. The problem is that you can't just go out and classify all of them because it's just intractable.
Yeah, but I don't know.
Classifying groups.
Yeah, of course. Quantum groups, you know, worse or modular tensor categories. No, I agree. It could be too super difficult. But even proving that this is the only possibility, for me, is not clear. I mean, maybe we can talk again. You have a way to prove that there, in all each one of these phases, is exactly classified by the set of fusion rule. I mean, that there exists a set of quasi particles which are excitations of a Hamiltonian, for which I mean, this I would like to see if it's a proof of that. I mean, if I believe that this could be the case, but of course it's a bit of the aim of this program. But if this has been proven, I would like to see it. I mean, let's say. So question two, good. And then so this motivates the second question, which is so in this talk is step one, but we want not just a representative, but a handable description of the representative. So question two is give a handable description of this tensor for these representatives. Okay. And if this is handable enough, and we'll have all the properties that Jutos will need to use in order to, from these properties, derive kind of the anionic properties of the system, then in a sense we have gone in the right way, because really we have classified or understand the properties of each one of the phases, except those of course that we missed in all the reductions, in the right way, let's say. Okay? So this is question two. Good. So now let's go to the real talk. This is good. So first, I would like to say that in the 1D case, 1D pure case, so pure meaning that I have pure states, essentially this has been solved in a reasonably old paper by have many authors. I don't know if I forget Frank, definitely. Michael Wolf, I think Ignacio also, maybe Enrique Rico and José Ignacio La Torre, I don't know if someone else. Do you remember? They solve both questions. So I remember question two is gives this handable description, and question one, I remember somewhere, like here, question one was whether zero correlation length is indeed equivalent to a fixed point. Okay, for gap phases, for gap systems. Okay. So what they do is they prove result theorem is that if I have zero correlation length, I will now explain what exactly this means in the context of MPS. This is equivalent of having an RG fixed point. So I have my MPS A like that. I take two copies. I can apply a unitary here in such a way that I recover a single copy together with some product state. So this means it's an RG fixed point. And the RG flow is simply blocking and applying this unitary. End of the story, okay? And this is equivalent to have a handout description of the A's. So the MPS, so if you want the MPS, psi A, must be the direct product, so direct sum, sorry, of...
Wait, so your definition of an RG involves just blocking two sites?
Yes, yes, yes. In the 1D case, two sides. Yes. Of course. You have to. No, no. I mean, this is an RG fixed point. No, the RG for the RG flow, you maybe have to block more and more and more. So this is that if I have zero correlation length, it's equivalent of being an RG fixed point. So I'm not talking about the flows. I'm talking about being a fixed point. Being a fixed point when you are in the fixed point limit, of course, when you take a single step of the normalization, you obtain the same object. And in this case, in the fixed point, it's enough to block two. But in the fixed point, to arrive to the fixed point, maybe you have to block more and take limits and all these things. Okay, so this is really handable. So I have really, this means entangled states between pairs. And then I apply unitary operators here. And so on and so forth. Okay, so this is a product state between sides. So each side divides as a tensor product of two left and right Hilbert spaces. There is a direct sum structure, and then I simply have with a proper choose of bases, I have simply a product state or a direct sum of product states. Okay.
What is the direct sum, sir?
Out of here.
So to allow for
GST. For GST state. Okay. So, and this is done. So now, what do we want to do is the 1D mixed case and the 2D case. And this is the results. And indeed, they are essentially equivalent. First of all, because, as we will see now if I have time, the proof is essentially the same for both cases. But there is something more than that. I mean, we know by this kind of boundary theory work that maybe Didier is... Are you going to talk about the boundary theories in your talk or...? No, okay, so... boundary theories for PEPs is it started in a very nice work of Frank, Didier, Norbert, Ignacio, and I don't know if someone else, in which they show that in PEPs, one can understand kind of the physics of the PEPs looking at the boundary, and the boundary now is a 1D mixed state, and one can understand the topology, the existence of topology, and these things based on this correspondence, that of course is kind of an holographic correspondence, if you want. But okay, if you don't want to use this kind of boundary bulk correspondence, you can simply use the same tricks, the same proofs, to prove this and this separately, and that's it. So this is kind of simply that. Philosophically, we expected already that this was, that if we solve 1D mix, we solve 2D. Okay? Okay, so 1D mixed. I forgot, that's important, which is, I promise to say it, which is the definition of zero correlation length for matrix product states. Okay, that's important. So before this, mixed, this one won, before what zero correlation length means in MPS. And the idea is that if I have an MPS, this probably all you know, but let me just say it. If I consider this object, which I call E, which is the transfer operator, I define zero correlation length by saying that E squared is a projector. Okay? And why this is a notion that has anything to do with correlation length? For that, it's enough to go to refresh talk and remember how we computed expectation values. So I have an MPS and I would like to compute the expectation value of two observables. Then what I have to do is to sandwich the MPS with itself And in the two positions where the observables are, put the observables. No? So you have some picture like. Where you have here the observable 1, the NPS everywhere, and observable 2. And now this object. So this object is E. So this object is E to the N. But E to the N is E. Okay? So indeed, I don't care where I put the observables. Okay? So there is no length in the system. Okay? There is the distance between observables doesn't matter at all.
So correlation doesn't decay with distance at all.
At all, at all, no, it's zero, really zero.
It's like infinite correlation,
right? Okay, no, infinite, okay, okay. It could be yeah, okay, this is a very fair point. It could be also infinite. It could be zero or infinite, but infinite we call zero. We call zero also. Yes. Okay? Yes. Okay?
So the connected correlators yes. Are zero.
Yes. Or connected if you put in the middle, yes. A projector. So let's say the projector to the ground space, something like that if you want. But yeah, okay. Yes. Good. This is the definition. And now how I do the 1D mixed case. Then of course I would like to reduce to the 1D pure case. So in the 1D mixed case, I have an operator, matrix point operator, with two indices. This is ket and bra, which is semi-definite positive, as I'm mapping from down to up. Of course, I can always consider these two indices up and, I mean, the ket and the bra as a single index. Assume that this is a matrix product state and apply this. Okay? That's kind of okay. But I don't want to do this. And the reason is that if I do this, I have unitary operations that act simultaneously on ket and bra. And these are not physical operations. I mean, the physical operations here is conjugation by U data. So if I go directly here, I mean, I won't obtain a physical operation. Okay? So then I have to reason differently. So the trick is to not consider only rho, but rho to the power L. And this is already a 2D structure. And this is, you start to see that solving 1D and solving 2D will be the same. Now, okay, this is Rho2D. Okay, then, now in Rho2D, not in Rho, but in Rho2D, then I do identify this index and this index as a single index. So let me now put here a different color. Okay. Now what I do is I take this. Sorry, the hold this here. And I write this as a big tensor with the two indices, the black and the green, up. I did nothing, okay? And I consider the NPS generated by this object. The NPS, so if I, now, I can see this object if you want as something like this. And then this and this. But this index is kind of pretty big, no? But this is an NPS now. And then the fact that I don't have any length in the system, okay, what I use of this is that this object doesn't have a length. So that this object as an NPS has zero correlation length. And this is kind of my hypothesis. So what I'm using about rho, about the fact that rho has no length. I'm using that if I consider rho to the L, And I see it as an MPS, it has zero correlation length in this formal definition. So this is an hypothesis. So, or indeed the fact that the exact fact I'm using, that there is no length in the system generated by rho. Okay?
You can do the same thing with L equal to 1. So why you choose L?
Aha! Good. And the reason is exactly the following. So I use the one, it will come in a second, and it's a very nice point because it will clarify why we need the L. And indeed, which are the technical difficulties to prove the 1D or the 2D case. So let me just do it, and then I will simply state the results. If we understand this, I will state the results because they are proved in a similar way. So, exactly. So then I use the 1D thing, and I know that, assume that E squared equal to E. So I take this with the peak. Peak, the green equal to square. Okay, the same thing square. But now, since rho is positive, this object is nothing but the same as there, closed when I have here 2 to the L, or say 2 times L. Okay? Good. So what I know is that this is equal. Two times itself. Okay. And now what I'm going to use is I'm going to see this and this as a matrix product state in the other direction. And for that I need this to have arbitrary length n. And this is why I'm using it. Now we see this as an MPS in this direction. And now we know. Okay, and this is the tricky thing, result. And I put, okay, because the result is in general not true. And to prove that under the condition which is true hold here is all the difficulty. Okay? That two MPS are equal if and only if they are related by a gauge transformation. It was something that Xie Chen was using in her talk yesterday, no? Okay, the result is false in general. It's true under certain conditions, it's true in the generic case, but it's not true in general. The fact that it's true for us is what took us most of the effort, okay? But now, it's true, assume it. Now, I have two MPS which are equal. So it means that the tensor that defines the MPS and the tensor that defines this one must be related by a gauge. So this implies that if I take this and I apply a gauge, so u dagger, I disentangle, so this means that I have the single copy tensor some entangled state here, some state, which is an RG fixed point. So I mean the scheme of the proof is super easy, and if this would be if this were true always, it would be indeed a trivial result. But the thing is that it's not true always, and it's not easy to check that the conditions you need for this to be true are satisfied here. This is kind of the hard part. Okay. So essentially, I think that's it. I won't do any extra proof, but with similar techniques, one can prove. So this solves question one for the mixed case.
Sorry, can you summarize what you just did?
Not
how you did it, but what the conclusion is.
Exactly, I will write it. Theorem. So let's say, sort of theorem. For question one, in the 1D mixed case, is whenever I have a 1D matrix product density operator with zero correlation length. And zero correlation length means really that rho to the L formally does not have any length for any L. Because if it had any, you can keep renormalizing in such a way that at some point it disappears. So it's simply that you didn't reach the RG fixed point. So it's.
So I'm confused. So yes. You are talking about rho.
Yes.
Density metric that you express as
an. Yes. Entity, yes.
And that has zero correlation line, and the formal definition of that is
that rho. The exact thing I need for this is but that rho to DL has zero correlation length, which has an MTS.
Right.
But this means this.
No, but something is the definition, and then something is the property you need. So, what's the definition of zero correlation length for an MTO? What do you mean by zero correlation?
The same happens in the MPS case. In the MPS case,
isn't it the property of one dependence and called it local zero?
Sorry?
One dependence that things factorize from the moment. So it's not a product, but if there is any space in between two regions, then they become independent.
The thing is, so let's say that if you trace something in between, you get a tensor product.
Yes.
Yeah, but of course the thing is that if you do this,
that's the consequence of E squared.
Yeah, exactly. In this case, yes, definitely. Yes. Mm-hmm. So what I mean is that, so our game is the following. We allow ourselves to assume that there is no length at all in the system. So if there is some length in any kind of sense, we can keep renormalizing till this length disappears. And then the way we use this here is it could be that rho itself has some, doesn't have any correlation length, but if you take rho squared, there is a length.
But how is rho squared related to the problem of rho? I mean, rho
no,
squared is another object, right?
No, but it's, I mean, the thing is that the object, you are maybe thinking of rho as a physical thing. No, for us, rho is a tensor. Because remember, the motivation of all this is understanding things in these tensors. So for us, rho is a tensor. It's just a tensor.
That's fine, but I thought you were going to show that for 1D mixed states,
yes,
something holds.
Yes.
And
what holds is this. But of course, you have to say what zero correlation length means. But even in 1D, you have to say it. And the definition is this one, in the pure case. But in this is not the same as having zero correlation length. So this is not equivalent as this being independent of the position of O. This is much stronger than this.
Okay.
But the thing is that if this is not true, you can keep renormalizing, and then by renormalization you take powers of E. So in the end, in the limit, the eigenvalues can be only 1 and 0, and this is true.
No, but if this was not true, then you would find some correlators.
No, this is false. No, this is false.
Sorry?
This is false. Take the zero plus state. This is permutationally invariant. Has no correlation at all. But it's not a fixed point. It's not an RG fixed point. I mean, E squared is not equal to E here. And you cannot find any correlations in this state. Because it's permutationally invariant, no?
It's a mixed state, though.
But the 0, 0, 0 plus 1, 1, 1, 1 is also mixed in the thermodynamic limit, but this has zero correlation length, it's an RG fixed point and everything. So there is a difference. So this property is much stronger than this. But you see here that if you keep renormalizing, you are obtaining something in which this is getting more and more close to E. So this is what I mean, that we are asking to have no length at all in the system. Indeed, that any property that after blocking, kind of you are reducing to zero, let's say, you may assume that it's zero.
But is there any, so can you state the same things,
yes,
the same conditions in terms of physical quantities?
Fair point, not clear.
Okay.
So physical meaning something that you can observe on this state itself? No, it's not clear. No.
From the point of view, for instance, this correlation function doesn't depend on the distance, can be two situations. Far away, if correlation is zero or not, I mean, can be not dependent on the distance, there's no correlation length, but whether it's O1 or 2 or the distance, is this zero or it's not zero? And this is like different between extremely different physics.
I agree. So of course, but the thing is that we want to include things like GSC, because in this thing, what appears when you have topological phases. So if you allow only for real zero correlation length, you are killing all topological models.
Can you say what the rank of E is? Generically, it should be like 1, right?
Generically, but of course, exactly topological systems are not generic. So if you want to I mean, for topological models, this essentially, I mean, 1D there is no topology. I mean, GSC is the closest thing, but in this case the rank is not 1. In 2D, if you look at E kind of as a block thing, the rank for topological models won't be 1 ever. Because the rank is related to the degeneracy in the torus. And of course it cannot be 1. So of course we have to deal with these non-generic cases if we want to cover topological models. Sorry, I'm.
Just a comment regarding to what Peter was saying. So you can probably don't want to enter into that. There is an alternative way of showing the same thing, which relies in a definition that goes more into the direction that you want, which is, you know, that for mixed states, the mutual information of a block is produced an area law. And so you can define the zero correlation of the fixed points of the renormalization group when you have saturated the mutual information. Okay, so that in one side you saturate the mutual information and it will give you the same result. It's a property of a single density operator,
right,
that requires the mutual information, and it's equivalent to this.
But this mutual information reflects correlations.
Yeah.
Right? So it's a, you're saying,
yeah. I'm saying that there is an answer to your question,
okay,
in terms of correlation, just by looking at the mutual information.
Perfect.
There's an alternative proof. It's a completely different word that gives the same result. But that's a way of doing that.
Okay.
And it's equivalent to just taking this power rho to the L and imposing that rho to the L has zero correlation length in the way that David has defined.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, so let's put here this, or the fact that kind of you have equality in the, I mean, structural relativity, no? So kind of you saturate mutual information. No? Any of the equality, structural relativity, strong. So I give you the computer information. Or saturated if you want computer information. Different area. Then this implies an RG is the same. It implies an RG fixed point. So in this sense, here. And now this is physical because it's UU DAGA, what I'm doing. Okay? Good. Okay, so I will simply state the result in 2D. Related to question 1, we have some finer version related to question 2, some internal structure, but I won't talk about this just to finish. So. Question 1 in 2D. And then again, now what we do, I mean, to see that it's exactly the same proof, is I'm going to consider not just the PEPS itself. This is the PEPS, this is A. I'm going to consider kind of the transfer operator, which is this object, which is what appears when you consider expectation values. So I call this E. And then what I'm going to assume in 2D is that if I consider one this fixed and I move this has zero correlation length as a kind of a one-dimensional system in this direction, and the same in the other direction. It's 2D pure now. Okay, so I consider different system sizes of kind of rectangular shape, and I consider that if I fix one and consider the other as the growing direction, it has zero correlation length as a big MPS, and the same in the other direction. This is my assumption. Okay, and the same in the other direction. Then, under this assumption, we can prove. So indeed, this now is this. Oh, again, the object has the same shape. We can use the same tools, and we obtain something like this. Okay. But the thing is that now, since we have now also zero correlation length in the other direction that we could not use before, this two tensor has special properties. Okay. And with these special properties, one can prove that if this is true, so it has zero correlation length in this direction and also in the other direction, and I'm interested in this object, in this E, then what I can obtain is that if I take E, say four times if you want, this is the same, this is equal. I conclude upstairs here, this is the end. If this is equal to a single E, and now objects with, I mean, with the property that this is the identity, and this is the identity. Okay? So again, it's, I mean, four copies is the same as one copy, with some isometries that, of course, you have to do. So again, zero correlation length implies RG fixed point. This is RG fixed point. Okay. Now, in this case, I mean, there is no issue about the, see, okay, can argue, but I'm not taking something which is not physical, simply talking about different shapes of my region. Okay, going to your question. Okay, and that's it. Thank you for your attention.
So, David, I'm a bit confused. Yes. So there were many definitions of what you meant by zero correlation length and so on, but maybe this would clarify. So if I start with some tensors,
yes,
and I cross-grain it by taking four tensors together,
yes,
and then I apply some, maybe the effective body indices, I can apply some isometry to reduce dimension. If I kept doing this,
yes,
do you expect to get to this situation?
Yes, because you are taking this flow. So indeed, you expect that in the limit, you have a fixed point of this flow. So all the point is, from some property we does not choose any particular flow, you obtain a flow. But of course, if you start with something which is a particular flow and you take the limit, you expect that in the limit the flow is satisfied with the quality. If there is a limit in the process. So the main thing is to introduce conditions which has to do with the correlation length that imply this. And then I think that is like probably the best way to state this is not with this, but with this other result. Of course, the proof using this has nothing to do with this. It's much, much more sophisticated.
But then your point is that from now on, you can restrict your search to tensors that fulfill this condition.
Yes, yes, exactly. And we have another two theorems involving question two, in which we have, indeed, E has a very particular internal structure, which implies this equality. But a very particular internal structure that one may use then in order to understand how to obtain the physics from E. More than simply having this property. So there are two theorems also in the 1D mix and in the 2D which give this internal structure. But they are more technical and they don't have time. But if you're interested, I tell you, I mean, have them prepared.
Other questions?
Okay.
So this last picture?
Is this equal to this, you mean?
Yeah, so I'm not clear with these.
Yeah, sorry. So this is a tensor. I call this up tensor, down tensor. There is no physical index, eh? It's a three-leg tensor.
Yeah.
I call this right, I call this left, and simply if I have this is up, and this is down, this is identity. And if I have here right and left, this is identity. So what is the inverse of the other?
They're just pseudo inverses. They're like partialized, they're inverses. Or partial
inverses, yeah. In principle, unless you impose extra thing, they don't have to be, one adjoint of the other, because of course, can use some yy minus one that kills this, but it's like you want like that. Yes.
Questions? Okay, let's start speaking again.